Well, good morning. Morning. Are you ready for this coming week? I hope so. Hope so. A lot of exciting possibilities with Vacation Bible School. I want to remind you that, Diane, we need them here, 8:30 at the latest? Yes. If you can be here, if you're going to be a part of the team that's working it, 8:30, we need you here by then. Children will be lining up probably by that time, and registration, all that good stuff happening on the parking lot tomorrow morning. So be ready. I think the weather looks good for at least the first three, maybe 4 days this week. So let's hope what they're predicting, they follow through with. Be good for VBS. I want to let you know that if you have not had a chance to give hot dogs and buns for Thursday night at the park, you can still bring those and leave them at the office. We'll make sure that the guys get that to cook at the park on Thursday night for our family night. Also, for the meals for the BSU team coming in this afternoon, the openings, if I remember right, are tonight's meal, tomorrow night's, and also Friday at lunch. Everything else is covered. So if you haven't had a chance and want to either provide a meal or take them somewhere, feel free to sign up even after the service today. It's on the bulletin board down by the office. One good thing about us, I'll tell you, we have a good rep with the college down there. They say that we feed them well, we treat them well, and we are good hosts. And that's a reputation I like to have. At the state level. The people know that Morganfield takes care of our guests. So if you want to sign up, I appreciate that. Last thing, if you're a guest with us the first time this morning, we're glad that you're here. We're here simply for one thing, worship Jesus Christ and honor him as our creator. And if you have not had a chance to fill out a card, you'll find one in the pew in front of you. Fill that out and drop in the plate a little bit later on, especially if there's a need that we can meet in your life or a prayer concern. We'd love to be able to pray for you this week as a staff. Other than that, it's good to have you here. Stand up and welcome someone, if you will.
So, some Buckeyes.
Well, good morning. Let's pray, and I'll tell you what, heaven's going to sound like that. It's going to be a good sound with God's people together. So let's pray and enter worship as we ask him to receive us in his presence this morning. Father, Vacation Bible School, what an exciting opportunity. We simply plant seeds and trust that what we teach from your word will yield fruit in the future. Lord, your Holy Spirit will bring many of these things, these lessons, these teachings to their remembrance. It may be a year, 2 years, or even five. But Lord, we trust that what we invest, Lord, with our efforts, you will take and multiply it. And Lord, that you will call these kids to you someday. That's our hope and our prayer. We know it's yours. Lord, as we worship this morning, simply receive our adoration as our creator and the one who gives us the very breath that we have. You deserve that. So, Lord, receive our worship this morning. In your name we pray. Amen.
Good morning. How's everybody doing this morning? You didn't know you were coming to Asana this morning, did you? Yeah. Well, hopefully we'll have that fixed for VBS this week. So, let's praise God this morning.
It's the song of the redeemed, rising from the African plains. It's the song of the forgiven, drowning out the Amazon rain. The song of Asian believers, filled with God's holy fire. It's every tribe, every tongue, every nation, love song born of a grateful choir. It's all God's children singing glory, glory, hallelujah, he reigns. He echo from the towers of cathedrals to the faithful gathered underground. All the songs sung from the dawn of creation, some were meant to persist. Of all the bells rung from a thousand steeples, none rings truer than this. It's all God's children singing glory, glory, hallelujah, reign. He reigns. It's all God's children singing glory, glory, hallelujah, reign. He reigns. And all the powers of darkness tremble at what they just heard. 'Cause all the powers of darkness can't drown out a single word. When all God's children sing out glory, glory, hallelujah, reign, he reigns. All God's children singing glory, glory,
yeah.
You know, faith is, Pastor's going to talk about that today, what faith is. But I know this, we don't like to assume things, but faith, in reality, has to make some assumptions. The assumption of trust in whatever object that you're placing your faith, whether it's that chair or pew you're sitting in, whether it's that roof that's not going to leak, you trust it, or whether it's a Savior you can't see. And so this morning, short and sweet, I found in my life there's four or five things that are tough for me sometimes in my faith. And I remember when I was at seminary, they taught us when you make a poster, what are the things you put on there? Who, what, where, when, why, and sometimes how. And I find those are the questions in my life that sometimes require faith more than anything else. Those are the questions, the who, the what's going to happen, the where do I go, when do I do this, the timing of things in life. Those are the issues and the questions that sometimes we question God the most about. And I think the pastor is going to share that with us as Abraham dealt with some of those questions in his own life and had to look at himself and say, do I trust this God with those questions in my life? Let's pray. Jesus, humanly, we live this life moment to moment and day to day. And we know that you see all. You know what's coming in our life tomorrow, a month from now, a year from now. Where our fear creeps in is we don't know those answers. And so that's where we sometimes need to spiritually assume and trust that you do and let that build into our faith, knowing that when we don't have the answers, you will. And you will reveal them to us at the appropriate time in our life. So Lord, with the who's, what's, when's, how's, where's, why's, help us to give those things to you so that we can have that peace that passes all understanding that you promise us. Help us to see those things in Abraham as he had those questions too. In your name we pray. Amen.
We just come to you this morning. Thank you so much for, again, for your grace that is undeserved and for putting up with us when we go astray, where we want to go, what we want to do when we rebel against you, Lord. And Father, I'm so thankful for everyone that's here this morning, and I pray a special blessing over them. For if they're on a mountaintop or in a valley, Lord, wherever they're at, I pray that they know that you're near always and that you love them deeply and desperately. And I'm reminded in that song when it says, love so amazing, love so divine, demands my soul, my life, my all. That's not just part of us, Lord. It's all of us. And Father, I for myself, and I pray everyone here lays their all down to you this morning. Father, and I pray that that comes through in our giving this morning as well, that you take it and that you turn it into what you want it to be and where you want it to go, and give us the vision and the understanding and the boldness to act in that. In your name I pray. Amen.
I want to build four walls, keep you safe inside, and catch you when you fall. Don't want to see you cry. When you walk down the street, make you hold my hand. I wanna lift you off your feet, be your Superman, Superman. I wanna take you for a ride when you cannot sleep. Brush your hair to the side, kiss you on your cheek. I wanna stay up all night, making sure you breathe. Oh my God, what a gift He has given me. Yeah, I brought you into this world, and I'm sorry it's a little bit crazy, but I tell you there was so much good. Though the future looks a little bit hazy, but see, God, me and Him have a promise, and He'll give us everything that we need. So have faith, hope, and love. Faith, hope, and love. Repeat. Climb the mountain tops, watch you dance in the rain. I hope it never stops. Whatever tomorrow brings, I hope it brings you joy. When it's all too much, I'll hold you in my arms. And I brought you into this world, and I'm sorry it's a little bit crazy, but I tell you there is so much good. Though the future looks a little bit hazy, cause you got me and Him, I promise He'll give us everything that we need. So have faith, hope, and love. Faith, hope, and love. But there will be days when you lose your faith, and there will be nights when you give up hope. Disappointment and pain, and you flirt with the shame, so you call me from the end of your rope.
crazy, but I tell you there is so much good. Though the future looks a little bit hazy, you see God being here, not a promise. You give us everything that we need, so have faith, hope, and love.
Please do not interpret this as a political statement. Children are a gift from God, no matter the circumstance. And I am pro-life, pro-Jesus. Faith, hope, and love. And the greatest of these is love. I started thinking about the summer several months ago, and I had in my mind exactly what I wanted to do. Speaking of my political statement earlier, which I never have made in 10 years, but I wanted to talk about controversies in our nation and the church in particular, and I felt prepared and ready to go, and I set up those meetings, and it's... You ever been on one of those roads? Pam and I went out to dinner last night, and we got to a green light, and I had three choices. Right, left, straight. So I kind of went all three and finally made it to the left, to which she responded, "What are you doing?" And I said, "Do you want to drive?" She said, "Yeah, get out of the way. I'll drive." God had other plans. And so I've been thinking about and praying about this, and God said, what I want you to do is talk a little bit about faith, and we're going to continue this idea of building biblical character and talking about biblical characters. And so we're going to mention Abraham today. It's not a huge thing on Abraham himself, but I wanted to talk about faith. And so this morning we're going to look at facing life with faith. Do you have faith? This is not a trick question. Do you have faith? Oh my goodness, look who's in the house today. Oh my goodness. If I knew you were coming, I would have prepared. The owner of a photographer's studio tells of a college boy who came in with a framed picture of his girlfriend there. He wanted the picture duplicated. So in removing the photograph from the frame, the studio owner noticed the inscription on the back written by the girlfriend. It said, "My dearest Tommy, I love you with all of my heart. I love you more and more each day. I will love you forever and ever and ever. I am yours for all eternity." It was signed, "Love, Tammy." And it contained a P.S. And the P.S. said this: "Should we ever break up, I want this picture back." So much for loving you forever. I think we all start out with an idea or a passion that, well, we're going to come to Christ and that we're going to have faith and we're going to build on our faith and we're going to trust God and everything's good. As Mike Tyson said, everyone has a plan until they get punched in the mouth, right? We all have a plan until something goes awry. We all have an idea of what God wants to do in our life until the plan goes at a different position or a different angle or a different direction or on a certain path. We knew for sure the path that God was going to lead us, but God had other plans. Faith is an interesting concept. You would think as Christ followers that you and I would have this idea down, that we're not going to lose faith. But as in many things dealing with spirituality, it is something of a process. And by the way, we never get to complete faith or complete hope or complete love until we see Jesus face to face in eternity. So everything that we're doing at best is an idea of a process. And by the way, none of us are on equal footing. Some people have little faith. Some people have huge faith. Some people have misideas about faith. People will tell me, don't talk to me about faith, when they're the very person we need to talk to about faith, because their idea of faith from a biblical perspective is not right. Some of the greatest Bible characters had to learn a great deal about faith. And we're going to dive into God's word and turn to Hebrew. Would you stand with me in the honor of reading God's holy word? See, faith is the confidence that what we hope for will actually happen. It gives us assurance about things we cannot see. Through their faith, the people in days of old earned a good reputation. And by faith, we understand that the entire universe was formed at God's command, that what we now see did not come from anything that can be seen. Let's pray. Father, we talk about faith, but in reality, we want to believe in things we can see and experience and touch and feel. But our spiritual faith is so important. It is vital to a spiritual life and to the spiritual life of a church or a culture or a community or even a nation. When we talk about faith and we talk big, but when something happens, our faith tends to sparkle not as bright. So remind us today that you want to develop in us a better faith, because tougher days are coming in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. Now, just three verses down, I think Hebrews 11:6 is also very powerful. And it says this: without faith, it is what? Impossible to please God. You can be a Christian. You can be a giving Christian. You can be a Bible student Christian. You can attend seminaries. You can go on mission trips. You can do all kinds. You can be involved in vacation Bible school. And God help us, right? It's going to be a crazy week. But if you don't have faith, it says it's impossible to please God. Wait a minute, God. I'm taking time out of my life to do this for you. I'm giving of my resources. I'm doing this and that, as if we could obtain God's favor by doing more, or that we could get God's pat on our back or clock in, make sure that we get our spiritual stuff done, right, our checklist, that somehow God's blessings will be greater on us by the more that we do. Now, there's nothing wrong with doing many things, but without faith, right, it's impossible to please God. Anyone who comes to him must believe that he exists and that he rewards those who earnestly seek him. Earnestly. That's a word we don't use a lot in our language today. Earnestly. I knew an earnest once. Earnestly desiring. Without faith, it's impossible to please God. That tells us how important it is, that the Christian life is really pretty simple. I can sum it into two words. Well, three if you want to add hope. But love and faith. Love God with all your heart and love your neighbor as, are you with me this morning? With yourself, as yourself. That's it. Without faith, it's impossible to please God. So what is faith? Well, it's difficult to define in one sentence or even one message. That's why we're going to look at it all summer long. By the time we get done with August, you're going to be like, okay, I've had enough of this faith. Let's move on. And to be honestly, I'm not even sure the 3 months will do it all. Faith is like a diamond. It sparkles. It has many multifaceted ideas. It has a lot of aspects to it. In fact, this morning, I'm going to give you at least six aspects of faith from this classic chapter on faith in Hebrews 11. This is considered by most theologians as the hall of fame of God's faithful, Hebrews 11. You see, faith is being sure of what we hope for and certain of what we do not see. Faith is being sure of what we hope for and certain of what we do not see. Humanity tells us, our world, our neighbors, those who are non-Christians would say, believing, seeing is believing. God tells us just the opposite. He says, believing is seeing. And some things in life you have to believe before you can see them. Now, this is a little before my time, but not much. But for example, in 1960, President John F. Kennedy stood up and said, and I quote, "Let's put a man on the moon by the end of the decade," end of quote. When he made that statement, that technology had not been invented yet to accomplish that task. There was a dream. Faith is being sure of what we hope for and certain of what we do not see. Everything in life that we have as a resource was an impossibility before it became a reality. Alexander Graham Bell, right? He invented what? This is a test. Telephone. How many attempts did he try? Like 99, and on the 100th one? So he called everybody he knew and told them it was good. He left. Faith is simply trusting God to turn our dreams into reality. If you want to see great things done for God, have a vision. Have a dream. You dream it before it becomes reality. You think about it and you look at it and you measure it. Kind of like a golf shot, right, Mark? You're supposed to visualize before you swing, not just get up and blast it. Visualize, and you're hoping that it will go where you're visualizing. 99% of the time, mine doesn't. 99% of the times, our passions don't match what God's vision is. As Blackaby says, find where God is at work and join him there, not you go on and work and have God join what you're doing. Have faith. You have to dream it to be it. If you want a successful marriage, you have to dream it before it can be there. You have to work at it, but you've got to visualize a peace. And then, as God would say, as an encouragement, be a peacemaker. It's amazing that when we give encouragement, we get what? And if we get hope, we receive. And if we give encouragements, you get. I know you're all are hot, but come on. Faith is obeying when we don't understand it. Hebrews 11, on to verse 8. It was faith that made Abraham obey God when God called him out to a country God had promised him. He left his own country without knowing where he was going. I just love this. A great true story. Abraham is living in the city of what? For 100 points, Alex. In the city of Ur in the Chaldees. Can you imagine someone ask you where you live? I live in Ur. You never heard of Ur? That's where I'm from. And God says, look, I know you're 75 years old. And while you're drawing your Social Security, I want you to pack up. You're going to have social insecurity. You're going to want to build a permanent structure. You want to finally build the house of your dreams where you live in Ur. And you want to have a rocking chair on the front stoop, and you want to have a permanent structure, and you want to relax, and you want to be able to just live in your life and live in luxury and cruise, and you want to just kind of hang through life, and you just want to be entertained, and you don't want to have any problems, and you want all your technology to work. You want your car to start when you get in it. You want just whatever you think about, the American dream. Of course, Abraham wasn't American, right? But it's the same human thing. We all just want to live a life of comfort, a life of luxury. We all just want to sit back. We want to build something permanent, and then we want to sit back and go, look what I have built. As if God didn't have anything. So he's 75 years old, and he wants to build a permanent structure. God says, take it all down. Pack up. We're leaving. Abraham asks, where are we going? That's a logical question. If Bill says we're going somewhere, wouldn't you want to know where you're going before you just get in the car with Bill? Am I the only one? Are you kidding me? None of you would get in the car with Bill not knowing where you were going. And if you are, you get what you deserve. Who knows where you're going to land? You could be at a lamp show. You could be at a flea market. You could be in Bryan, Ohio, which is a long, long way from here. Where are we going? God says, I'll tell you when you get there. By the way, you're going to be responsible for building a great nation. Are you talking to somebody else? No, Abraham, I'm talking to you. God says, you're going to build a great nation out of me. Are you serious? I'm winding down. I've been there, done that, and wrote the book, got the check, wearing the t-shirt. I'm retiring from this idea of ministry and leading. I'm tired. I'm worn out. I'm done. God says, yeah, out of you. And Abraham says, well, how will I know when we get there? And God says, I'll tell you. Would you go? Faith is obeying God when you don't understand it. There are a lot of people who want a guarantee of success before they try anything. And in our day, we want a warranty. If this mattress isn't the best thing you've ever laid on, in 90 days, you can return it for a full money refund. Yeah, right. We want a guarantee with our purchase. We want a guarantee with our buy-in. I will come to church, but you guarantee me blessings. You guarantee me a rich, full life. You guarantee me spiritual success, business success, family success, and I'm in. No, that's not what God says. In fact, you give your life for God, you're going to go through the hardest things you've ever been through in your life. Church and Christianity is not for sissies. Weak people need not apply, because the enemy is going to come after you with everything that it's got. And you're either going to have faith to withstand, or you're going to fold under pressure. And I'm telling you, more than once, there have been people who stood, like Peter said, I will never deny you. No way. You are my Lord. You're my Savior. I will back you. I will kill for you. I will do whatever it takes. And before the rooster crowed three times, he had denied him three times. The very person that you would believe of all people not to give in to the pressures of people would be Peter. But you and I, we stand strong in faith today. I wonder what would happen if someone came in here and held us and asked each of us, as they did Cassie Barnell and the Columbine shooting, do you believe in God? And she said, yes, I do. And then he shot her point blank. It all sounds good, but it always takes a risk. God wants to force you to trust him. By the way, you know what one of the greatest tests of your faith is? Forgiveness. It never seems like the right thing to do, but it's always the right thing to do. And even when you don't feel like doing it, we need to obey God when it doesn't seem right to us. As a kid, did your parents ever tell you to do something that you didn't want to do? And at the time, it didn't make sense to you? Oh, people, they don't have a clue what they're doing. You don't say that about your parents, do you? I mean, you know, think about that. I mean, you know, parents, what do they know? They're not understand me. They don't understand my influence. They don't understand my culture. They don't understand Facebook. They don't get anything. They're very old school. But then years later, you look back and go, that was some pretty wise comments that I should have listened to. That's the way God is with us. You see, faith is giving when we don't have it. Giving and faith go hand in hand. In fact, God uses finances to test us all the time. Have you ever had to make a decision whether you're going to pay a bill or you're going to tithe? We have. That's a test. God's testing you to see how much you trust Him. How much do you believe? And there are basically two ways that you can give. You can give by faith or you can give out of fear. Giving by fear is when we say, how much can I afford to give you, God? Let's see, let me work you into the plan, the budget. And giving by faith is when we say, God, how much do you want me to give? And next Sunday, I'm going to talk a little bit more about this idea from Abel in the Old Testament. You see, Abel was a man who gave out of faith, an offering acceptable to the Lord, but it cost him something. 2 Corinthians 8, out of extreme poverty welled up rich generosity. They gave as much as they were able and even beyond their ability. It's one thing to give when you've got it to spare. It's another thing to give when you don't know where it's going to come from. Same thing in church. I don't know how we're going to pay for that, but we're going to trust God. I don't know about you. I've been here 10 years. Maybe you know something better than I know. Has God ever disappointed us? Has God ever not given what we needed financially? Has there been something as a church that we haven't accomplished? Is there something that is out there that we just haven't done because God hasn't given us the... No. God always takes care of what He calls us to do. Now, I'm not saying we'd be careless or unplanned, but I'm saying we probably need to increase our faith. Faith is persisting when we don't feel like it. Our culture says base everything you do on how you feel. You going to church this morning? I'm not feeling it. I don't feel good today. I got a sty in my eye. There's a crink in my back. I didn't sleep real well. I think I'll skip it. You going to work today? I have to because that's how I get paid. But even in our culture, especially in our young people, does it really mean anything? Will I be missed? There's no more employee loyalty or loyalty to employers. That's a thing of the past. It's all, what have you done for me lately? And the same concept is in the church as well. If young people come into the church and there's nothing here that exceeds their expectations, they will just simply go to the next market, the next place. And by the way, sometimes that's another church, and sometimes that's the ball field, and sometimes that's the swimming pool, and sometimes that's the mall, and sometimes that's doing some yard work that needed to get done because I didn't get it done yesterday. If they don't find what's relative, they move on in our culture. The older generation, the builders, they understood the concept of faith and trust church and be here, and thank God you are here. Because without you, I'm not sure we would survive. If you don't feel like doing it, you just don't do it in our culture, which is a guaranteed formula for immaturity. I don't feel like it. Because immature people build their lives on feelings rather than on commitment. I don't really feel that love, so move on to the next one. This idea of commitment. What happens when you live your life based on how you feel? Well, you end up being manipulated by your moods. You flip-flop around because you feel different from day to day. The reality is I don't feel like always doing what is right. Do you? I don't always feel like being so sweet to my wife. Do you? I don't always want to spend time with my family. I don't always want to stand up here every single Sunday and talk to you on some days. But the issue is not how do I feel, but rather do I understand it's the right thing to do. It is my calling, it is my responsibility. And by the way, until God changes that, that's what I'll be doing. Here is a great definition of success. Successful people do what most people don't feel like doing. Successful people stay with it. They persevere. They have faith that God is going to take care of it. That's how you become a success. Successful people simply develop habits that unsuccessful people don't feel like developing, like using their time wisely, being persistent, sharpening their skills. You don't become a master musician by practicing only when you feel like it. You don't become a super salesman or a sales lady when you don't feel like making calls today. And godly men and women don't get by just by feeling it. Develop some habits in your life, some disciplines like having a daily time with God, and do it whether they feel like it or not, and that pleases God. You say, well, you mean even if I don't feel like spending time with God, but that still pleases Him? Why? Because you're doing it in faith, and faith pleases God. Faith is being persistent. It is refusing to give up, no matter how tired you get. And finally, faith is thanking God before we receive what we ask. A really great example of this is from the book of Joshua. You remember the story, right? By faith, the walls of Jericho fell after the people had marched around for 7 days. After the nation of Israel finally got to the promised land, which, by the way, Moses did not ever get to see until later, and I'll explain that. They finally got to the promised land, and the first thing they encountered was the most fortified city in the world. And God said, this is now your land. Giants live here, God. This is your land. They have weapons, God. This is your land. They're bigger than me, God. This is your land. How are we supposed to defeat this enemy? I want you to march around the city every day and thank me in advance. So that's what they did. Now here's a people, the nation of Israel, that have been slaves for 400 years. They are not a trained army. They have no weapons. God says, here's my plan. Walk around the city and once a day for 6 days, just march in silence. And then on the seventh day, I want you to march around it 7 times. And I want you to be thanking me in advance and trusting me. And this is going to be a statement of faith by your marching around because you expect me to work. I'm sure they felt pretty silly going on a parade around the most fortified city in the world. And eventually, as the old black spiritual song says, and the walls came a what? A tumbling down. Sang that in high school. God gave him victory. They thank God in advance. If you have a problem in your life and you think God can solve it, that's not faith. Now hear me out. Faith isn't believing God can do it. God can do it whether you believe it or not. Faith isn't even believing He will do it. That's called hope. I hope I get this job. I hope He'll find me a marriage partner. I hope I get well. Faith is thanking God before He answers. It's believing that God is already doing it. Faith is trusting if we don't get what we want. Two great things about prayer. God always hears every prayer and answers every prayer from all believers. I didn't say He answers prayers for everyone, for His believers. And He does not always answer the way we want Him to answer. Why would God say no or wait? Why? Because He doesn't love you? Because He wants to exercise authority over you? No, because He does love you. He knows what's better for you than you know what's better for you. God is not a vending machine. You ever go to a vending machine? I like the new ones. Now you can put your cards in, right? Slide your card in, get a Coke. They don't tell you exactly how much it costs till you get your bill. and then your wife yells at you because she's the CFO in our family, you spent $4 on a Coke? Honey, I just used the card and I put it in. I didn't know. Pay attention. Yes, ma'am. Pay attention. God is not a vending machine. You want the chips? It's A12. I like to have these little cookies. Y'all like the cookies, the Oreo things. I'd C32. That's one of the first things you learn as a kid. We do the same thing as adults. We treat God as a vending machine. Need a new spouse. F3. I need a new church. G1. I need a better car. H8. We go through our whole list of things that we think that we want from God, and we treat God, whether you want to call him a genie in the bottle, which, by the way, I heard the new Aladdin movie is great, but I also know that we treat God like Aladdin sometimes. We want to rub the magic lamp, have God come out, and we ask God. He says, I grant you 3 wishes. You mention them, God doesn't grant them, and then you get mad. You see, God's only going to give you what is for your benefit and for his glory. Let me repeat that in case you didn't get it. God is only going to grant you what really benefits you and what gives him glory. You know what I've discovered over the years? I found that if you could understand everything about God and understand why he does answer the way he does when it doesn't make sense to us, if he were small enough for us to understand, he wouldn't be big enough to answer our problems. If you could understand everything about God, he wouldn't be God. Even in my own life, the very hurts and pains that I had prayed for relief from over the years that were not removed, the very hurts and pains that caused the eventual greatest blessings in my life, it's made me what I am today. It's built character into my life, gave me a ministry that God wanted me to have. The very things that I wanted most desperately to be removed so I would be comfortable were the very things that God shaped me into who I am today. Not who you wanted me to be. And finally, faith is a lifestyle. It's a lifestyle that believes that when I don't see it, obeys it when I don't understand it, gives when I don't have it, persists when we don't feel like it, thanks God before we receive it, and trust God if we don't get it. Martin Luther King had a dream for racial equality. He did not see it happen in his lifetime. We still hope and pray for it today. But that doesn't mean he didn't have faith. Moses had a dream of going into the promised land, but he died in the desert. Some say he never did go to the promised land, but he's still a great man of faith. Did you know actually he did get to go to the promised land? Because on the Mount of Transfiguration, when God brought him there to meet with Elijah and Christ, the three of them talked, and he's standing on the promised land. He did not see it physically, but he saw it in his glorified body spiritually. If you think that we're going to go to heaven and just disappear, we're not. Have faith that there's another side, that God is going to actually answer his prayers, and it's going to actually be better than here. What am I saying? To have faith like a child is trusting God even when we don't understand everything. A lot of times God just gives us pictures of faith.
You know, I believe God's a God of pictures. And 4 years ago, we gave birth to a picture. I didn't know at the time, but God knew. About 20 weeks into the pregnancy, my wife contracted cytomegalovirus, a virus that causes mild to severe handicap. And in Abby's case, she had a stroke in utero, and so she was severely handicapped. Severely in that she's visually impaired. Her eyes see, but her brain just doesn't allow her to transmit it. She was born deaf. She couldn't hear. She couldn't hear much of anything. And in my embrace, when I'm playing with her and throwing her up in the air, she is completely happy. She's totally dependent upon me. To me, Abby is a picture of childlike faith, of complete and 100% trust and dependence upon Jesus. We are a lot like Abby. We're totally dependent upon the Father holding us close and whispering in our ears, "I love you."
You have no idea what you're going to experience in life. I know as a church, we're going to experience Vacation Bible School this week. And there are going to be children that come from homes where there's no food. And so every snack we give them is more than they've gotten. That every hug that they get this week will be more than they get at home. And you and I are the hands and feet of Jesus. So have faith that what we do matters. And you may not ever know it until you get to heaven one day, if then. But we don't do it for that. Have some faith that God knows what he's doing. Let's pray. God, we just ask your blessings on this invitation experience now. God, that you would utilize it for your glory and for our benefit. That we would develop some aspects of faith. Just because we don't feel like doing something doesn't mean it's still not the right thing to do. Give us courage to live in faith when everyone else around us doesn't. And we'll give you the glory. In Jesus' name, amen. Have some faith.